Good morning friends, welcome back. Hope you all are enjoying my lectures, and today we are going to start another very important lecture. Myself Dr. Jibran Ahmed presents to you Simply Pathology, and today we are back with another very important lecture, that is MHC, that is the major histocompatibility complex. Yes, this is a very interesting yet difficult topic. So we are going to go slow and we are going to make sure that you understand every bit of it. So without wasting any time, let us start the MHC complex molecule. So what is the MHC? First of all, the MHC stands for the major histocompatibility complex. Okay, so it is basically a peptide display system of adaptive immunity. Okay, the basic function of the MHC molecule is to display the peptide fragments which are derived from the microbes or the protein antigens for recognition by the antigen specific T cells. Okay, in human beings, okay, in us, the MHC is also called as HLA, that is the human leukocyte antigen. And the genes which are encoding the HLA molecules, they are present on a small segment of chromosome number 6. Mind it, where I have made a question mark means these are very important MCQs which has come in various examination. So let us first try to understand diagrammatically how an MHC works. So this is an antigen presenting cell. Okay, so this antigen presenting cell, it cannot go and directly, okay, just take a molecule and go directly and present it to the T lymphocyte. No, this antigen presenting cell has a certain presenter that is called as an MHC. Okay, that is called as an MHC. So here is the antigen presenting cell and below is the T lymphocyte. Now this antigen presenting cell is having a molecule that is called as the MHC, and this MHC is a peptide display system, means they are going to present some antigens or some peptide fragment to the T lymphocyte. And this MHC, see, it is carrying a peptide fragment, and now it is going to present it to the T lymphocyte. Okay, just remember that this HLA system is highly polymorphic. Polymorphic means it has a lot of variations. Okay, so this because of this polymorphic nature of the HLA system, it forms a formidable barrier in organ transplantation. So suffices to say that the basic graft rejection or all the problems which are arising during organ transplantation is because of HLA. Okay, so whatever problems we are having of graft rejection is because of this HLA system. Okay, moving ahead. Location of the genes in the HLA complex and the structure of MHC class 1 and class 2. So again, this is very important diagram. So this first structure that I have shown with an arrow is actually a gene with a location of different genes which encode different parts. So first we will see this A, C and B. So this HLA A, HLA B and HLA C, okay, these particular genes are going to code for class 1 MHC molecule. Yes, MHC are of two types. We are having class 1 and we are having class 2. So these set of genes, that is A, B and C, they are going to code for class 1 MHC molecule. So looking at the structure of the class 1 MHC molecule, if you see, so this is how the class 1 MHC molecule looks like. So what is it composed of? It is composed of a polymorphic alpha chain. Why polymorphic? Because it is composed of three units, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Hence it is a polymorphic alpha chain, and it is a heavy chain. It is larger than the other chain. So which is the other chain? That is the beta chain. It is non-polymorphic. Why we are saying non-polymorphic? Which is composed because it is composed of just one unit, that is the beta 2 microglobulin. Okay, now this is the alpha 2 and this is the alpha 1. So this alpha 1 and alpha 2 domain is forming the antigen binding cleft. See, the peptide is binding between the alpha 1 and alpha 2. This is another very important MCQ. Okay, so in class 1, which is the antigen binding cleft? That is the alpha 1, alpha 2 forms the antigen binding cleft, or it is a site for binding of the peptide antigens. Okay, moving ahead, if you see now the other sides of this gene, so this is the whole gene, okay, and they are showing the locus for different kinds of genes. So we have already read about HLA ABC. Now we are reading about the other genes, DP, DQDR. Now these three genes, these are the HLA-D genes, okay, they are three main types, they are encoding for class 2 MHC molecule. So when they are coding for the class 2 MHC molecule, so what are the components of the class 2 MHC molecule? How do they look? So this is exactly how a class 2 MHC molecule looks like. It is again composed of an alpha chain, which is again polymorphic because it is composed of alpha 1 and alpha 2. And we have a beta chain again, unlike the MHC class 2, this beta gene is composed of again beta 1 and beta 2, again they are polymorphic. So in class 2 MHC molecule, both the alpha chain and the beta chain, they are polymorphic. And as well, you can see over here, the antigen binding cleft is formed by alpha 1 as well as beta 1. So alpha 1 as well as beta 1 domain is forming the antigen binding cleft. It is the site where the peptide antigens are going to bind. So this is all about the structure of the MHC and the location of the different genes in the HLA. Okay, now you see there is another group of genes, the class 3 molecules, which are basically encoding the complement proteins. As well as we are having certain genes, okay, the cytokine secreting genes, okay, which are secreting TNF and leukotrienes. Okay, now moving ahead, the class 1 MHC, let us read about the class 1 MHC in details. So if you see, the class 1 MHC is expressed on all the nucleated cells and the platelets. And it is a heterodimer. Why we are saying hetero? Because it is composed of two different kinds of chain. That is why hetero, and dimer because there are two different types. So we are having one polymorphic alpha chain, the heavy chain, which I have already shown you. And we are having a non-polymorphic beta 2 microglobulin, okay, which is the light chain. Now both this alpha and the beta 2 are linked by a non-covalent bond. Okay, and the alpha chain is encoded by three genes, as I have already showed you before. That is the HLA A, B and C. Moving ahead, if you see, as we have already discussed this important MCQ, the alpha 1 alpha 2 domain is forming a cleft or a groove where the peptides are going to bind. The class 1 MHC molecule displays peptides that are derived from proteins such as the viral and the tumor antigens, which are located inside the cytoplasm and which are usually produced inside the cell. So try to understand one thing very, very nicely. The class 1 MHC is going to present antigens which are derived mainly from the virus and from the tumor. Okay, so just remember this thing. And the class 1 MHC, they are presenting the antigens to the CD8 plus T lymphocytes. Okay, so Robbins, they write like this, that the class 1 associated peptides are recognized by CD8 plus T lymphocyte. In other words, that the class 1 MHC are going to present those peptides to the CD8 plus T lymphocyte. Moving ahead, the class 1 MHC, if you see, one important aspect of class 1 MHC is that class 1 MHC is present in all nucleated cells. Okay, you have to remember they are present in all nucleated cells. Okay, so just remember more about the class 1 MHC, how these are presenting the antigens. Suppose there are certain cytoplasmic proteins which are derived from virus or any tumor. They are degraded in the proteasomes and they form peptides. Okay, these peptides are taken to the endoplasmic reticulum, where these peptides are going to bind with class 1 MHC molecule. Now, after they are binding to class 1 MHC molecule, they will associate themselves with beta 2 microglobulin. Then a stable trimer will be formed. And now the MHC along with the peptide is transported to the cell surface. Okay, moving ahead, now alpha 3 domain of the MHC, that is the class 1 MHC, has the binding site for the CD8 plus T cells, that is the cytotoxic T cells. So this is again a very important MCQ. So the question is like this, that which domain of class 1 MHC has the binding site for CD8 plus T lymphocyte? So the answer will be alpha 3 domain. Okay, now the CD8 molecule is a co-receptor for CD8 plus T cell. So as we have already discussed in our previous lecture on adaptive immunity, I have already explained that the CD4 and the CD8, both of them are acting as a co-receptor for CD8 and CD4 respectively. So this CD8 molecule is going to bind to the class 1 MHC heavy chain, that is the alpha 3 chain. Okay, the CD8 plus T cell is going to screen all the nucleated cells of our body. Okay, because the virus is going to infect just the nucleated cells. That is why remember that the CD8 plus T cells is going to bind to class 1 MHC, and class 1 MHC is present in all the nucleated cells, and nucleated cells are being targeted by the viruses. So we can say that the CD8 plus T lymphocytes, they are class 1 MHC restricted, meaning that CD8 plus T cells are only going to act against those cells which are going to present the antigen with the help of class 1 MHC. Okay, now CD8 plus T cells will eliminate the viruses and the tumor cells. Okay, moving ahead, the class 2 MHC molecule. As we have already discussed, the class 2 MHC molecules are encoded in a region called as HLA-D, which is composed of HLA-DP, DQ and DR. Now each class 2 molecule is a heterodimer. Again, I told you they are composed of two chains. One is an alpha and a beta chain. So they are heterodimer and they are non-covalently associated. Okay, we are having one alpha chain and beta chain. Now remember, both these chains over here are polymorphic. Why polymorphic? Because they are composed of different subunits. For example, alpha composed of alpha 1, alpha 2, beta composed of beta 1, beta 2. So they are polymorphic. Again, an important MCQ, the peptide binding cleft of the class 2 MHC is formed by alpha 1 and beta 1 domain. The class 2 MHC molecule will present antigens that are internalized into vesicles and which are typically derived from extracellular microbes and soluble proteins. So here is the difference. As you will see, the class 1 MHC molecule used to present antigens derived from the viruses and tumors basically, but over here they are presenting extracellular microbes. So those microbes which are extracellular, so what will happen, all the antigens or the proteins or the peptides which are derived from these extracellular microbes, okay, they will be presented by the class 2 MHC. So these proteins derived from the extracellular microbes are internalized and they are proteolytically digested in the endosomes and lysosomes, and the peptides from this proteolytic cleavage will associate with class 2 MHC inside the vesicles. And this will form the stable peptide MHC complex, will go to the cell surface, and then the class 2 MHC on the antigen presenting cell is going to bind, okay, to the beta 2 domain, okay, to the beta 2 domain. So the beta 2 domain of the class 2 MHC has the binding site for the CD4 plus T lymphocyte. Remember, in case of class 1 MHC, it was the alpha 3 domain. Alpha 3 domain was binding with the CD8 plus molecule, and over here in class 2, the beta 2 domain is binding with the CD4 plus T lymphocyte. Therefore, we can say that CD4 plus T cells are class 2 MHC restricted, whereas the CD8 plus T cells, they were class 1 MHC restricted. Now, the class 2 MHC, they are present on the cells that present ingested microbes, and they respond to the T cell help. Okay, so the which are the cells which are having this class 2? So as you will remember that class 1 MHC were present in all the nucleated cells of our body, but the class 2 MHCs are present on the antigen presenting cells, mainly the dendritic cells, macrophages and B lymphocytes. Okay, now moving ahead, HLA polymorphism. Again, it is a very, very important topic. So just keep all your ears open when I'm discussing this part, because this will need your attention. Now, HLA polymorphism is very, very important. Now, first you will have to try to understand one important concept. The combination of the HLA alleles in each individual is called as an HLA haplotype. Okay, so I know you did not understand anything. Just let me make it clear to you. Suppose this is a gene. So a gene can be composed of two or more alleles. Commonly they have two alleles, but they can have two and more alleles. Okay. So whenever there is a gene, okay, they can have multiple alleles for that gene. Okay. So similarly, HLA gene is formed by multiple HLA alleles. Okay, they form. Any given individual, for example, like me and you, we are going to inherit one set of HLA gene from each parent. Okay, and therefore we can have different molecules for every locus. So what is important, I would just like to tell you in one line, HLA of my body is different than HLA of my brother and my sister, or it is quite different from you and from other. So my HLA system is different from your HLA system, and everyone's HLA system is quite unique. Okay, so you have to remember that my HLA will be more close to my brother and my sister, but they are not exactly the same. Similarly, the HLA of my body will be quite different from anyone else who is not related to me. Okay, so just to give you one example, look at it. There is a mother and there is a father, and they have their own set of genes. So you will see for HLA A gene, okay, mother is having two sets of alleles. One is 9, one is 3. Similarly, for HLA B, they are having two alleles, 4 and 6. For HLA DR, they are having two sets, that is 2 and 15. Similarly, for the father is also different. So how a child is going to inherit? So as I already told you, the child is going to inherit one set of genes or one set of alleles, okay, for each gene from the mother, and another set he will attain from the father. So the child is having a completely different set of genes, and this all takes place by genetic recombination. Okay, so they have permutation combinations, and for example, one child can have 942 and 1711, another child can have 942 29185, another child can have 365. So there can be various permutation combination. That is why every individual, you know, just like a DNA fingerprint, we are also having a very unique HLA system. And this HLA system, because it is different in different individuals, therefore we call it as HLA polymorphism, because this part is not same in all individuals. Okay, so, and this part is also because of this HLA polymorphism, we are having graft rejections or organ transplantation rejections because of this HLA polymorphism. Okay, hope you have understood this part. Moving ahead, so why we are reading about HLA polymorphism now? Okay, so there is one advantage and there is one disadvantage of HLA polymorphism. Okay, so the advantage is that at least some individuals in a species would be able to display any microbial peptide and thus provide protection against infection. So this is a very, very important concept. Okay, now you will understand, now is the era of COVID-19. You are seeing that some person, they are not having any symptoms. Okay, they are having very, very mild symptom. Whereas some person, they are having very severe symptoms. They are having pneumonia, they are having pulmonary pneumonia, they are having respiratory distress syndrome, RDS. And some of them are even dying. Okay, so why is it so? But what is the important? Because all of us are having a different HLA system. So at least some people in our community, they are having a resistance against COVID-19. That is why this is the advantage. For example, if all of us had the same HLA system, okay, and all of us couldn't present this COVID-19 antigen to our T cell, then what would happen? All of us would have died. But over here, we can provide some resistance. So at least some people in our community, they are providing resistance to COVID-19, because of which our human race is continuing. Okay, so this is the advantage. Okay, and the advantage can be seen now in this pandemic. Now, what is the disadvantage? The disadvantage is that no two individuals are having the same HLA system. Except identical twins, no two individuals are likely to express the same MHC molecule. So just in case of twins, they will have the same MHC. Else, even between brothers and sisters who are not twins, they will not be having the same HLA system. So this is the basis for graft rejection. If my body HLA is not same as your body HLA, so all cells in our body are having this HLA system. So if I take a graft from your body and if I plant that particular graft in my body is going to reject it. So this is the basic disadvantage of HLA polymorphism. Hope you have understood this part. Moving ahead, how does the MHC molecule regulate the T cell mediated immune response? Again, this is very, very important that our MHC molecule is regulating the T cell mediated or the cell mediated immune response. How? So as different antigenic peptides are going to bind to different MHC molecules, okay, it follows that an individual will mount an immune response against a protein antigen only if he or she is having the gene for that particular MHC molecule that can bind the peptides derived from the antigen and present it to the T cells. So it is a very simple concept. The concept is that I can only present one particular antigen to a T cell if I have the MHC molecule specific for that antigen, because we know to present an antigen we need an MHC, and that MHC should be able to recognize a particular peptide so that it can display. So if my MHC cannot recognize only that particular antigen, it will not be able to present it. And if my MHC can recognize that particular antigen, then it will be able to present, and there will be a subsequent immune response against that particular antigen. So I will give you two scenarios. It can be a good thing, it can be a bad thing. For example, antigens, for example, we take into consideration pollen grains. Okay, so if an individual is having certain MHC molecules which can recognize these pollen grains, and they are going to present these pollen grains to the T cell. So what will happen? That person genetically will be more prone to allergic reaction. So this is forming the basis that why some person, if you see in your class, there are some person, they are always sneezing. They are always, their eyes is watery. They are always using handkerchief. They always have this allergic reaction. Why? Because they are having certain MHC in their body which is presenting pollen grains or any certain antigens, okay, which normally, usually we are not sensitive to those, but their body are possessing certain MHC molecule which can present the environmental antigens on a daily basis. So they are more prone to allergic reaction because they are having certain MHC molecule which can recognize particular antigens. So this is one basis of the reaction. Another thing is that, for example, now the antigen is a bacterial peptide. So if I, as an individual, I am having a MHC molecule that is going to present that particular bacterial peptide, then my body can mount an immune response. Similarly, if for example a person, we say that his body is not strong, his immunity is not strong, what do I mean? That his body is lacking the MHC molecules that can recognize the bacterial peptide for a subsequent immune response. Okay, so this is the basic difference. Okay, so hope you have understood this part. So moving ahead, number two. So by segregating the cytoplasmic and the intracellular and the internalized antigens, okay, from the extracellular microbes, the MHC molecules are ensuring that the correct immune response is mounted against different microbes. So what we are trying to say over here is that our immune system is differentiating between those antigens which are presented as an intracellular microbe or intracellular antigen and those microbes which are extracellular. Okay, so why it is important? Because the cytotoxic T lymphocyte mediated killing of the cells which are harboring cytoplasmic microbes. So if there is any intracellular microbe or cytoplasmic antigen, so what kind of immune response will occur against them? Cytotoxic T lymphocyte mediated killing will happen of those particular cells. Whereas the helper T lymphocyte mediated antibody and macrophage activation is there to combat extracellular microbes. So in case of extracellular microbes, I can say the CD4 plus T cell response, that is the helper T cell response, is more common. And in case of intracellular microbes, cytotoxic T cell killing is more common. Okay, moving ahead, the cytokines and the immune system. We have already read about the mediators of inflammation in the chapter on acute inflammation, but now we are seeing what is the role of cytokines in our immune system. So the cytokines are basically the messenger molecules of the immune system, and molecularly defined cytokines, they are called interleukins. And why they are called interleukins? Because they are mediating the communication between leukocytes, hence they are called as interleukins. So majority of the cytokines, if you will see, they are having an autocrine action, means they are releasing certain means there is a cell which is releasing a cytokine, and that cytokine is modulating the actions of that cell only. Now there are some which are having paracrine, means there is one cell which is releasing certain cytokine which is modulating the action of another nearby cell. And there are certain cytokines, okay, which are having, they can be endocrine. Endocrine means what? They are releasing the cytokines at one point, but their effect is far, far away. That is, effect is distant. So this is endocrine. Okay. In innate immune response, what is the role of cytokines? So the cytokines are produced very rapidly, and they're going to induce inflammation, and they're going to inhibit viral replication. The important cytokines in innate immune response, they are interleukin 1 and TNF, interleukin 12, type 1 interferon and interferon gamma, as well as chemokine. What is the source? The source of these, as you already know, we have read before, these are the macrophages mainly. Dendritic cells, natural killer cells, endothelial and epithelial cells. Moving ahead, in case of adaptive immune response, the cytokines are produced by CD4 plus T lymphocytes, and they promote the lymphocyte proliferation and differentiation, as well as they are going to stimulate the effector cells. What are the examples? The examples are interleukin 2, 4, 5, interleukin 17, interferon gamma. Now the anti-immune cytokines are the TGF beta and the interleukin number 10. Now moving ahead, some cytokines are also stimulating hematopoiesis, and these cytokines are called as colony stimulating factors or CSF. Now they are basically increasing the leukocyte number during immune and inflammatory response to replace the leukocytes which are consumed or lost during the process. And these cytokines are basically produced by the marrow stromal cells, T lymphocytes and macrophages. Now what are the examples of these colony stimulating factors? There are GM, that is granulocyte, monocyte, colony stimulating factor, and interleukin number 7. Moving ahead, now the tissues of the immune system. Now these are again very important topic. Why? Because a number of MCQs are based on these. So there are two basic important tissue of the immune system. One of them is the primary, central or generative. Another is the secondary or peripheral. Now the primary, central or generative immune system, they are responsible or related to the maturation of T and B lymphocyte. And the secondary or the peripheral immune system is associated with the adaptive immune responses to the microbes. So first we are going to read about the generative lymphoid organ. Now we have to understand that the generative lymphoid organs are those where maturation of the T and B lymphocytes occur. And the details of this we are going to read when we are going to start with hematology. Now which are the principal generative lymphoid organs? So they are two. One is the thymus, okay, where the T cells will develop or mature. And one is the bone marrow where the B cells are going to mature. Now we are going to read about the peripheral lymphoid organs. What are those? The lymph node, spleen, mucosal, as well as the cutaneous lymphoid tissues, which are organized to concentrate the antigens, antigen presenting cells and the lymphocytes. Okay. In a way, they optimize the interactions among these cells and the development of the adaptive immune response. So this is all what is the role of the peripheral lymphoid organs. So there are three main. One is the lymph node, spleen, and the cutaneous and mucosal lymphoid system. So we are going to see each of them in details. So first the lymph nodes. So lymph nodes has very importantly two important regions which are important MCQs. So this is the lymph node. Okay. So first we are having in the cortex or in the periphery, we are having lymphoid follicles, and lymphoid follicles are rich in the B cells. Now once the B cells, they encounter an antigen, the follicles will have a central pale area that is called as the germinal center. And they are having another area called as the paracortex, which are the area in between the follicles, then they are the ones which harbor the T lymphocytes. Now here we can see a naive B cell and we can see a naive T cell. Also in this diagram, which is not shown, is that there we are having a dendritic cell which is coming with an antigen via the afferent lymphatic vessels, and these antigen presenting cells, that is the dendritic cells, they are going to present the antigen to the naive T cell. So what is the importance over here? The naive cells are those cells which are immunologically inexperienced, okay, that is they have never encountered an antigen, and once they encounter an antigen, they become activated and then subsequent immune reactions will follow. So again, in the follicles or in the cortex, they are having certain dendritic cells which are called as the follicular dendritic cells, and their major role is activation of the B cells. Whereas in the paracortex, we are having those dendritic cells which are going to present antigen to the T cells and they are going to activate the T cells. Okay. Moving ahead, now the microbes from the epithelia, okay, in our body, they can directly travel via the lymphatic vessel and they can reach the lymph node. In that case, the dendritic cells inside the lymph node is going to present that microbe. Else the dendritic cells which are present in the epithelia, okay, they will recognize the microbe from the epithelia and tissues and carry them in the lymphatic vessels, and they will bring them in the lymph node and then present the antigen. So in both ways, these dendritic cells can present the antigens. Now second is the spleen. Now the spleen is going to sample the blood bone antigens instead of the lymph bone antigens, and these spleen is basically composed of multiple sinusoids. So blood bone antigens inside the sinusoids will enter the sinusoids of the spleen, where they are trapped by the dendritic cells and the macrophages. Now inside the spleen, the T lymphocytes are present in the periarteriolar lymphoid sheath surrounding the small arterioles, whereas the B lymphocytes are present in the splenic follicles. A third and the last is the cutaneous and the mucosal lymphoid organs. These are lymphoid tissue which is located under the epithelia of the skin and the gastrointestinal tract, as well as the respiratory tract. Moving ahead, what are the Examples. What are the examples of the mucosal lymphoid system? So we are having the pharyngeal tonsils, for example, and we are having the Peyer's patch of the intestine. Now, a very interesting fact is that more than 50% of the body lymphocytes are present in the mucosal tissues, and many of these, they are the memory cells. Now, lymphocyte recirculation. Now, remember that the lymphocytes consistently recirculate between the tissues and they home to particular sites. Okay. So, for example, the T lymphocytes, they are two types. One is the naive T lymphocytes. These are going to circulate through the peripheral lymphoid organs, whereas the effector T lymphocytes, they locate and they migrate to the sites of infection and they eliminate the microbe. Okay, similarly, the B lymphocytes and the plasma cells, both of them remain in the lymphoid organ. Okay, so once an antigen is presented to them, they are going to secrete antibody, and that particular antibody is going to go to distant sites and kill the microbes. Okay. Whereas the B lymphocytes and plasma cells are going to remain in the lymphoid organ. Okay, moving ahead, now we read something about the dendritic cells. So dendritic cells are also called as interdigitating dendritic cells, which is the most important antigen presenting cell for initiating the T cell response against the protein antigen, and they are having numerous fine cytoplasmic processes that resemble dendrites. Why are they preferred as antigen presenting cell? Because of their location just under the epithelia, plus they are present in the interstitia of all the tissues. What is interstitia? The space between the two cells is called as the interstitia. Now they express numerous receptors, including toll-like receptors and lectin, which helps them in recognition of microbes. In response to microbe, the dendritic cells are recruited to the T cell zones of the lymphoid organs to present the antigen to the T cells, and also they are having a very high expression of MHC molecule. Now I will ask you one question: which MHC molecule is present in dendritic cell? Is it class 1 or is it class 2? If you have understood my lecture, you will be able to answer this question. Moving ahead, the second type of cell with dendritic morphology, they are present in the germinal centers of the lymphoid follicles present in the lymph node and the spleen. And these dendritic cells are called as the follicular dendritic cells, which is bearing the Fc receptor for the IgG. So you all know that the antibodies are having a heavy chain and they have a light chain and they have an Fc tail. So these follicular dendritic cells are having a receptor for these Fc tail of the IgG antibodies, and they also have a receptor for the C3b complement protein. So they can trap all the antigens which are bound to the antibodies and the complement proteins. Also, they can present these antigens to the B cell, and they can select the B cells which is having the highest affinity for these antigens. Therefore, these follicular dendritic cells are also having a role in humoral immunity. Moving ahead, the last cell is the macrophage. They can also act as an antigen presenting cell by presenting the antigen to the T cells. Now, once the T cells have been activated by the macrophages, the T cells itself will activate the macrophage and will enhance their ability to kill the ingested microbes. So macrophages are also having a role in the cell mediated immunity. Macrophages also participate in the effector phase of the humoral immunity. How? As we have already seen before, if a microbe has been coated, okay, if this is a macrophage, if a microbe has been coated by an antibody, what will happen? That macrophage is going to cause phagocytosis and killing of that particular microbe, as we have seen before. So thank you very much, guys, for watching this lecture. Please subscribe and do comment and share and with those in need. And I do encourage all of you thoroughly go after all of my lectures. And also, one important request to all of my viewers is that most of my viewers, they haven't subscribed to my channel. So a humble request to all of you that please do subscribe my channel, because you don't want to miss any of my lectures. Thank you very much, guys. Stay tuned for more lectures.